Tatooine Sons, a Star Wars podcast, is a proud member of the Making Star Wars Podcast Network, the two-time winner of the Fan Favorite Podcast Network from the Star Wars Podcast Awards. To learn more, go to makingstarwars.net. Welcome, Star Wars fans, to episode 100 of Tatooine Sun.
Woo! Yeah! Yeah!
Yeah.
The Rise of Skywalker is finally here.
Woo! Yeah! Oh, sorry.
We've seen it twice already, but don't worry. We have some really fun, non-spoiler conversation to help celebrate it.
Yes, we do.
First, we have the behind-the-scenes story of how Terbus became canon, as told by Matt Martin on Lucasfilm Story Group. Second, an interview with Paul Hirsch, the Oscar-winning editor of the original version.
What?
And for those of you who have seen T-Ross, we'll jump into our spoiler review.
The dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural.
It's time for Tatooine Sons.
It's true. It's true.
What is the name of the Porg on the Millennium Falcon?
The Force is strong in my family.
What do you think his name is? It's a big moment.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Maybe Terbus?
Do. Oh, do not. There is no try.
Terbus? Pablo, if you're listening to this live stream, that Porg's name is now Terbus. It's a good Star Wars name.
We're not done yet.
These guys record an awesome podcast called Tatooine Sons. Everybody listen to it.
Welcome, Star Wars fans. This is Tatooine Sons, your weekly look into all things Star Wars. Through the unique perspective of a father sharing his love for the amazing space fan.
Amazing.
Sorry. Yes. Sorry. Amazing space
fan. I can't hold it back. Sorry.
With his two sons.
Yeah.
I am BB Nate, and I'm joined first by my brother, Samuel the Hutt.
Achuta, Star Wars fans. Thanks for tuning in. And if you're not a Star Wars fan, then go watch the movie.
Go watch it. Go. You will be afterwards. Sorry.
True. That is true. And, of course, you can't have Star Wars without very bizarre father figures.
Yeah, thanks.
So, on that note, here's my dad's bow tie.
I can't... First of all, two things are, like, blowing my mind right now. One, we just saw T-Ross twice, and we're going to be ready to see it again.
Right.
And it was amazing.
It was.
All right, we're gonna like, do a non-spoiler thing at the beginning here.
Mm-hmm.
For all of you that are listening to this, I'll let me walk you through... The other thing that I'm blown away right now is that we are in... This is our 100th... episode.
Great kid! Don't get cocky!
I can't believe.
Yeah, that's...
We made it to 100 episodes on this.
I'm not sure. Excuse me. I'm not sure how we pulled that off.
How you feeling, buddy?
Okay.
Yeah, he's been sick for almost a week.
Yeah.
We got him, like, all ready to go before we saw T-Ross at 7 p.m. and at 10:45 p.m. last night. Got home about 2 o'clock, crashed, recording a podcast, going to lunch, and seeing it all over again.
Right.
So.
Which... This is pretty cool.
Yeah, it's awesome. So this episode is obviously a very special episode. I just want to give you guys a shout out. All of you that listen to this, that share our stuff on Twitter, Facebook, on all that, YouTube, and have been a part of this crazy 2-year journey for us.
This kind of feels like melodramatic.
It really, like, melancholy.
Melancholy, that's
yeah.
What I'm talking about. Because, you know, the...
Melodramatic, too, for me. But anyway.
I'm sorry. Yeah, you're right.
I am melodramatic, though.
Melancholic, so. Yeah. Because the saga's ending. This is our 100th episode. It's weird.
And, you know, we've been talking the last few weeks internally about changing some things with what we're doing with the show going into the new year. And we'll talk about that on the next episode. But it is a little melancholy. I'm a little bit emotional about this. So this episode's going to be a lot different. All right, we've already recorded two interviews that'll be on this episode here in a few minutes. Nate mentioned it. We've got a special interview with Matt Martin from Lucasfilm Story Group. He's going to talk a little bit about how Terbus became canon on the inside. There's not a whole lot of story there. There's not like this major, like he had like committee meetings with Kathleen Kennedy or anything in order to make this happen. But it's a fun story. He's also going to talk just about Star Wars, and that's going to be so much fun. Then we're going to have an interview, which we'll play for you, with Paul Hirsch, the Academy Award-winning editor of Star Wars, 1977. Not special edition, not A New Hope, not the 1980 version that came in with Episode 4. We're talking Oscar-winning original Star Wars, and he talks about that story. That's a lot of fun. And before all of that, we're going to give our non-spoiler reactions, some poll results, all of that. So you're going to have probably an hour's worth of content to listen to at the front end of this that has no spoilers in it. We want to make that really clear so that you're not sitting there going,
I got a bad feeling about this.
You know, we want you to be a part of this show and celebrate this 100th episode. But then after that, we're going to make it really clear. We'll give you our warnings. We'll do the siren after the Paul Hirsch interview. And then we're diving into T-Ross. We got lots to talk about. I think there's a big point that I've only seen one other person talk about, and that was after Sammy said it yesterday. Brian Young, Swankmatron on Twitter, Full of Sith, mentioned something that Sam mentioned after our first viewing, and I think that it's something that nobody's really latched onto. We're going to talk about that and a whole lot more. All right. I don't even know where to start. Okay, so let's just do this. Let's go into last week's podcast poll results.
Are you brainless? I never ask that question till after I've done it.
What?
No! All right, so this, you know, we this poll came out before T-Ross did, so the question was, who's not going to make it out of T-Ross, The Rise of Skywalker? We gave you three options, and then you could share your own Leia, C-3PO, the Millennium Falcon, and other comment below. We had 684 votes.
Wow.
That's a lot of votes for us with it. And the runaway winner was going to be Leia, not making it out. I think that's logical.
Yeah.
I mean, just based on the reality that Carrie Fisher, our princess, has passed away 2 years ago. So, or 3 years ago. Can you believe it's been 3 years? Anyway, so they had to resolve that storyline. C-3PO, I think that was based on sort of what we saw in trailers.
Yeah.
All of that. The Millennium Falcon, that was a fun one to throw in there. There was a lot of speculation that it was going to crash and burn for good. With it. And then other comment below. So we had Leia with 48%, C-3PO with 25%, the Millennium Falcon with 16%, and 11% said other comment below. Charlie Skywalker, our good old buddy DJ Blake, he listed Falcon, Leia, Kylo, Palpatine, Lando Hux, all but one Knight of Ren, mini stormtroopers, flight crews, and civilians, but Terbus survives.
Okay.
I'll go with that one.
Yeah, I think
we haven't, like, this is like a completely improv, like, no plan show. So we haven't, we're like, sit there and figured out who's going to read which one. So I'm just going to read a few. Let's see, I'm going to read another one here. In my opinion, this is from Collector's Cantina. In my opinion, 3PO makes it out, but he won't be the same. The other two won't be as lucky. So they thought that Leia and Falcon weren't going to make it out. But then Jeff, good old buddy, Jeff Porgbach. Actually, it's Jeff Chewbach today. It was Porgbach for a long time. You can change your name without your Twitter handle.
Why is he though?
I don't know. He's a Chewie fan. He's a huge Chewbacca fan.
Oh, so, okay.
I voted for Leia, even though I do not want to see that. But one for me is Kylo Ren will not get out of T-Ross. He might get redeemed, but he will get his life for redemption. All right. That's the poll. We do not... Do not want to comment.
No.
Nope.
Because it will be hard for us to comment
with
having seen it twice
and
know the answers. All right. So why don't we go ahead and just get our hot takes on the Rise of Skywalker spoiler-free, non-spoiler hot takes coming up next.
This is where the fun begins.
Well, you want the bad news or the really bad news?
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
All right. So, again, no spoilers.
None.
Initial reactions. Now, let's set the table a little bit here. All right. For those of you that have been listening pretty regularly, some of this will be familiar to you. Okay. But I went into this film completely spoiled, like for months.
Mm-hmm. And he knew it.
And it was a choice I made. It's not like, I decided that's the way I was going to do it. So Force Awakens, I was spoiled but didn't know it. I thought it was just a cool fan theory that I read.
Yeah.
And it was a total spoiler. And that was disappointing from that perspective. Okay? Because I didn't know I was going to spoil it.
Right.
Last Jedi, completely non-spoilers just like you guys, right? So that was a different experience. This one, I wanted the experience of going in knowing I was completely spoiled. Okay. You two went in completely spoiler free, correct?
Yeah.
Right.
This is one of the only times.
Except for like trailers and stuff like that.
Right. Yeah. Trailers, TV spots, that kind of stuff.
This is one of the only times that I've disabled all social medias for a few days.
Yeah. And so critics' reviews coming out from Monday night with the premiere going into yesterday. Yeah.
I got a bad feeling about this.
Not exactly positive. About 56, 57%. Some angst. I had a lot of anxiety going into this film. Okay. We'll talk a little bit more about my responses here in a second, but what's interesting is that while the critics' scores have been at like 56, 57, audience scores coming out of it are in that 86, 87% range, in some cases up to 90, depending on the source that you're finding with that. Rotten Tomatoes is around 86. Okay.
Okay.
I know you guys went online last night on Twitter and did a video. Each of you had a Twitter video last night about it. But I'm going to start with you, BB Nate. All right, we're going to go youngest to oldest in this. I want to hear your non-spoiler thoughts on T-Ross.
It was a lot to take in, especially after the first viewing. I'm still thinking about it, trying to comprehend everything that I just saw. But it was very good. It is probably, I'll have to wait till the third showing, but it might be my favorite Star Wars movie. But that will have to wait. But it was a really good movie, but I don't want to like say anything really else because it might give away some spoilers.
I know, it's hard to talk about a film when you've seen it twice without actually talking about the film. Your expectations going into this film, what were they like? Like, after the critic reviews and some of the silliness that's been going on Twitter, which is a normal thing.
I was very nervous because the critics kind of liked Last Jedi. Like,
They loved Last Jedi.
So,
We loved The Last Jedi.
Yeah, exactly.
And we are Last Jedi apologists.
Yes. Right?
Rian Johnson's our dude. Okay?
So I was a little worried that since they didn't like it, I might not like it, so I was very nervous that I was going to go in and just really walk out disappointed, not satisfied.
I was kind of in the same boat.
Yeah.
Because of that. And there's so much sort of weirdness on social media since the critics' reviews started coming out, suggesting that JJ's retconning Ryan's stuff in The Last Jedi.
Yeah.
That it was like a complete reversal. Can we just address that from a non-spoiler position? Samuel the Hutt, do you feel like The Rise of Skywalker is a reversal of The Last Jedi?
No. No, I don't think so. I think he worked with everything that Ryan... It's tough to talk about.
I know, it is, but try to...
He worked with everything that Rian Johnson set up. He didn't go back on anything. He didn't retcon a bunch of stuff. He worked with what Rian Johnson gave him, which makes sense because it's not like Rian Johnson just went, hey, well...
Exactly.
So, no, I think he didn't retcon anything or change anything that Rian did.
No. And, I mean, a way that I think about this, if he was retconning, he would kind of, make it that Last Jedi kind of didn't exist.
almost like pickup from The Force Awakens. And there are those that seem to be suggesting that. That bothers me because there is a primary plot device in this film that cannot exist without The Last Jedi. And this isn't really a spoiler. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and we can talk. It's not. Because it's The Last Jedi, right? The Last Jedi is one of the most primary ideas or tools within it was the Force time connection between Kylo and Rey. Yeah. The ability to communicate through the Force, right? If you don't have The Last Jedi, that doesn't exist.
Right.
And this film does not happen. None of this story works. Can you see anything in this story working without the Force time connection?
I mean, just even some of the stuff. If you go in with watching Force Awakens and not Last Jedi, you'd be so lost during this whole film. It's just, Last Jedi is a very necessary film, and I felt like J.J. Abrams built off of that.
Awesome. All right, so we're going to ask you on the poll later, listeners, at the end of the show, what you think about this after you see it. But I want to get your guys's. I know you talked about this on the after the first viewing on your Twitter videos last night. I did as well. But now that you've seen it twice, even though it was like 1:30 and 2 in the morning when we finished and people were pretty tired with it. Samuel, you can go first. Out of 10 lightsabers, you can use halves. You can use halves. Go for it.
8.5.
8.5. Now, for context, where would you put The Last Jedi?
Ooh.
9.5.
Okay. And Force Awakens?
Oh, geez. 8.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you like this better than The Force Awakens?
Oh, yeah.
And almost as much, but not quite as much as The Last Jedi?
Yeah, that's about right.
Okay. Cool. BB Nate?
I would give this one...
Darn yourself. Yeah.
9.5.
Okay.
So it's up there.
Yeah, I think it's up there.
And same thing. Last Jedi, where do we put that?
I put Last Jedi at 9.
Wow.
And Force Awakens at an easy 8.5, 8.
Okay. So, but you're pretty light side, man, when it comes to
the reviews. I really love enjoyed everything. This movie.
It was. Yeah, it was funny, guys. Yeah. Walking out of the theater, so obviously, I mean, we saw it at 7 o'clock, and then we were going into the exact same auditorium for a 10:45 showing. So we had to clear the theater so they could clean it and do all the stuff that they do. We're standing in the lobby and BB Nate's sort of shaking. And I'm like, what's up, dude? He's like, I really liked that movie. with it. I think you're going to like it too. All right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and let things go ahead.
What about you?
Last Jedi is hard for me. I mean, that's become my favorite. And so I'm putting, that's a bar that's super high for me. Cinematography in that, storyline, mythology, all of that that was in Luke Skywalker in The Last Jedi, that elevates that one to, like, a 9.5 for me. I would put Force Awakens probably an 8. And then I'm going to put this somewhere in between right now.
About what I said.
Okay. Yeah, is where I'm going to go with it. All right, so here's what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and transition for just a second. Let you guys listen to the Terbus story from Matt Martin. And then it's going to transition again to the interview with Paul Hirsch, which I'm pretty excited about. And
so who talks first? You talk first? I talk first?
No. Matt talks first, and then... Paul Hirsch.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Poe's confused. Okay. And then we'll come back in and we'll give our spoilers after those. So when you finish up the Paul Hirsch interview, if you have not seen T-Ross, please pause, stop, go watch this movie, then come back and finish this episode. Yes. Are we cool?
Mm-hmm.
Well, in July of 2018, we were invited by Steele Saunders of Steel Wars podcast to meet up with a number of Star Wars content creators outside of San Diego Comic-Con. And while we were there, we met Matt Martin of Lucasfilm Story Group. Now, he graciously spent 15 minutes or so talking about Terbus the Porg. And at the end of the conversation, he mentioned that if Terbus could naturally become a part of the story, he thought it might have a chance. And now, a year and a half later, Terbus is canon. So Matt is joining us today on our 100th episode to tell his side of the story. Welcome to Tatooine Sons, Matt.
Thank you for having me.
So excited to have you on here. Okay, so now the question that I've been dying to ask for a year and a half is, when did you guys, like in Lucasfilm Story Group, first hear about what Ryan did at this Collider thing, and what was the reaction? Do you remember like hearing about Ryan telling this kid that he could name a character because of the whole Pablo Hidalgo thing he said on there? Do you remember any of that?
I mean, I'm pretty active on social media, so I'm pretty sure I just saw the clip on Twitter.
Okay.
I'm not sure if anybody else on the team, maybe I'm sure Pablo probably saw it, but I don't know if anybody else on the team.
I tagged him like crazy on that thing.
Yeah, so I'm sure he saw it, but I don't know if anybody else did. But you know, at the time we were just like, oh, that's cute, and what a random name for a porg.
Now, BB Nate, you should tell, I don't know if you explained to Matt when you guys talked with him at San Diego Comic-Con, but where does the name come from?
Our dog, which is another strange name of how you would come up with it, but his name is Buster, so we just decided that we should flip the syllables, because saying it backwards is like ret sub, and that just didn't sound right. So we're like, Terbus, and we're like, yeah, let's go with that. That sounds a little bit better.
So let's go. So it's a Tuckerization Star Wars name. Yeah,
that makes sense now.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no other way to make a Star Wars name, really.
I know. I was looking at the Wikipedia page about those Tuckerizations earlier, and it's amazing how many other names came from that same thing. Mm-hmm. So that's cool. So this was a pretty crazy thing for Ryan to say, and maybe it was just cute, and that's the way everybody took it. But do you know if we're trying to figure out, has any other like fan situation, like podcast or anything like that, ever had the opportunity to name a character in Star Wars canon in the new Disney era that you know of?
Not that I know of in the new Disney era. Before the acquisition, StarWars.com had a really cool thing where users could actually submit backstories for characters and names for characters, and those would potentially become the canon backstories for them. But we haven't done anything like that, to my knowledge, in a really long time. Hmm. And for the record, I submitted several of those, and they all got denied.
Oh, gosh. That's a cool idea, though. I mean, I can understand.
Yeah, it was really cool.
Yeah, I can understand why a lot of people are still really fond of like the pre-Disney era, because it was a much more community-based kind of feel.
Decisions and stuff like that. Yeah,
community was a lot more involved.
And you were really involved in the community long before the Disney acquisition, isn't that correct?
Yeah, that is true. I was the head of my local FanForce chapter from Ventura, California, and then I began volunteering for Lucasfilm, and I spent a lot of time at conventions and online with people, and yeah, it was just always kind of, you know, the Star Wars community was basically a big part of my life, you know, up to the point where I was old enough to drive and actually meet people.
Oh, that's so cool.
That's fun.
That's awesome. So now we've been dying to hear from your side of the story, kind of how this happened. I know that you we've interacted a little bit through social media and Twitter and stuff, talking about the Terbus thing over the last year and a half. But then in July, IDW announced this Journey to the Rise of Skywalker series of comics, Star Wars Adventures comics, and they had Terbus, or they had the Porg, I should say, at that time, front and center on some of the art. And I reached out to you and asked if that might have any possibility of being Terbus, and you said you didn't even know that there was Porgs on there, so you thought it wasn't going to happen. But then a month later, you told me that you had submitted his name. So I've got to hear that part of the story and kind of like when the decision was and what John Barber's reaction was and everything to it, because obviously it's all a done deal now. So,
I mean, the story is not as dramatic as you probably want it to be.
Well, it's cool for us.
So when you reached out originally, like you said, I didn't know that there were porgs in the story, because they actually have to submit the covers pretty early on for for sales solicitations. Mm. So typically we've at least, you know, seen kind of a one or two sentence blurb about what the story is going to be. That way the cover that they make can match the interiors, obviously. But that one, I don't think that particular blurb mentioned Porgs. It was just basically, you know, Chewie goes to Kashyyyk to take his home planet back from the First Order or something right. like that.
Yeah, the blurb itself does not mention Porgs at all.
Mm. Yeah, so, like, that's all I had at that time. And then when the pitch came through, there was already this Porg character that seemed important. And, you know, I... just like every other comic script, I was just reviewing the script and reading it as I do, and I'm making notes, and one of the notes that I put into the document was, hey, so there's this whole campaign about making a Porg named Terbus, and you have an opportunity to do that here and make some people really happy, so just throwing it out there, definitely no pressure, but that's a thing you can do. And I never actually even interacted with John directly about it other than that one note. It was just, here's a thing you can do. And then that might have been in the outline phase. I think that was in the outlines. And then when the script came through, it was like, there was a line about Terbus. And I was like, oh my God, he did it.
That's awesome. So now what you don't know about that story is right after I messaged you when that initial announcement from IDW came out and I saw the cover art with the Porg on it, I read on there that it was John and Derek, and I went and I found their Twitter and I started, like, for about 24 hours, I was really obnoxious, and then I forgot about it and didn't do it anymore because I didn't want to be too rude about it. But I sent them the videos, I explained the story, I told them how awesome it would be, pretty please, all that kind of stuff, and then we backed off. So it was pretty cool to see that was the comic that was a part of it. So
I might not have even had to say anything. That might have happened on its own.
Well, I'm sure that you're saying something was a big part of that.
You carry a lot more weight than we do. That's for sure.
That's for
sure. Yeah. I don't know.
That's cool.
So let's kind of switch gears a little bit. Let's stop, you know, ranting about Terbus. And so, like, with the overwhelming success of The Mandalorian on Disney Plus right now, and we got future series coming up like Kenobi and Cassian Andor that you could have told us about. Do you think that the future of Star Wars is on the streaming service or the big screen still?
I like to think that the future of Star Wars is as a transmedia franchise. Mm. I think it was, you know, it was one of the first franchises that I know of that really, really delved into different storytelling mediums, like really went into it more than most. So I think, yeah, I do think a part of the future is in the streaming service and a part is still in film, but just in general, I think, you know, what makes Star Wars so cool is that there are touch points that fans can interact with on so many different mediums. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, if we do it right, the future is all of those things.
Hmm. You know, and right now it's almost a bit overwhelming from a fan's perspective with all of the great comic book storylines going on, the novels that are out there, the Vader Immortal, which I know you were you worked on really heavily. Jedi Fallen Order, Mandalorian, everything else that's going on. It's almost like there's almost more content than we can take in, and it's coming across so many different medium. It's a lot of fun. What's it like on the story group side with all of this different content right now?
Busy. But, I mean, we all work on this stuff pretty far in advance, so it's like right now, I wouldn't say it's a slow time, but right now it's kind of weird, especially for me, because basically all of my big multi-year projects that I've been working on literally for like the last 3 or 4 years have all sort of hit in the latter half of this year with Fallen Order and Galaxy's Edge and Vader Immortal. And obviously, you know, books and comics and everything I work on too, but all of these big things that are hitting, and now Rise of the Resistance is opening in like 2 weeks in Orlando. Mm-hmm. It's just, it's nuts to see all of these things, you know, finally seeing the light of day. And And now looking at it, I'm like, wow, the next big things, like really massive projects that I have are another, you know, couple years away.
Wow. That's cool. So
I imagine it's a pretty rewarding feeling, though, to do all that work for so long and then eventually and finally see it come to fruition and see the fan response and everything. I imagine that that's a pretty amazing feeling.
It is when the fan response is good.
That's true. This is Star Wars we're talking about. Uh-oh. So,
unfortunately, at least for like those the projects that I'm more heavily involved in, the fan response has been really good. Like, mm-hmm. you know, I was particularly worried about Fallen Order, not because I didn't believe in it. Obviously, I think it's awesome, but mm-hmm. just because the gaming audience is particular and. Yeah. And they can be particularly mean. Mm-hmm. So, like, I never look at reviews, but that game, with the day that game came out, like, as soon as the review embargo lifted, I'm starting to look at the reviews just like,
Oh yeah, you're freaking out. Like, okay, am I loved? No, I mean...
Yeah, and myself and Steve Blank, who's another guy on the team, yeah. and, you know, games is really the thing that he leads, we're texting back and forth just like, oh my god, dude, they like it. They like it. We did it.
That's awesome.
BB Nate's favorite thing that's come out recently is Fallen Order.
Easily Fallen Order.
Oh, that's awesome.
Haven't finished it quite yet, but I've really just been trying to get through it, and I'm just enjoying it throughout the whole way. Just, like, of course, my thing is droids, so I'm loving BD-1 right now.
He's just really cool. Yeah, he's the best.
And giving him upgrades and then seeing him happy and all the questions that Cal asks him is...
And awesome. I have no idea what he's talking about right now because I've barely gotten through Zepho on
the first Zepho.
So.
Yeah.
So it's just one of my favorite games, but all of the things you've been working on, what's the most fun and rewarding project you've done?
Of these big ones that you've been working on over the last couple of years?
It has to be Galaxy's Edge. Mm. I'm from Southern California. Disneyland has been a huge part of my life, and it's no joke. Disneyland is my favorite place in the world. I go there almost, probably at least once a month. And to actually be able to, you know, build something within that park and have people be able to go and, like, live in Star Wars there is... It's pretty incredible.
Yeah, I've said multiple times that if they set up a way where you could live at that park, I'd probably live there. So
yeah, me too.
Yeah, that's cool. I can't wait to go.
Now, is the rumor true? They're coming up. They're trying to create these drone X-wings that they're going to fly over there. I mean, can we confirm or deny or no comment?
Yeah, as usual, probably no comment. But you know, it's. Imagineering, they can do a lot more than just drones, so I wouldn't put it past them.
Wow. That's pretty cool. Yeah, it's been all over that. So
they're magicians. They can do all kinds of crazy stuff. So drones almost seems like it would be too easy for them, but we'll see.
Okay.
So it's really exciting for us to have named a Star Wars character a canon one, but what's it like for you to actually be a canon Star Wars character?
Yeah, Martin Hatton.
It's definitely surreal, and I guess technically I'm kind of two characters now because I voiced the character in Galaxy's Edge. So, my voice is in one thing, and my name is in another.
That's so cool. And your image, according to Wikipedia, they patterned it after you. Is that true?
To an extent, that definitely had my older hair.
What was that like? How did you find out that they were going to do that? And what was that feeling like when that happened?
Oh, it was nuts. And that happened before I was on Story Group, too. But I didn't even believe it at first. It was basically what it was they made myself and Andy from Star Wars Show and John Harper from Star Wars Show made us into a group because we were the ones that were making Rebels Recon.
Right.
Uh-huh. So it was kind of like their homage to us in a way, which was really cool to see, you know, that team, you know, cared enough and appreciated what we were doing enough to do that for us, which was, you know, pretty nuts.
Yeah, I can imagine. That's an amazing...
I think the character actually... I think earlier versions of the character actually looked a little bit more like me. But when they decided that Mart would be Sato's nephew, they changed it a little bit more to, you know, reflect that lineage.
Mm-hmm. So... You know, how did that all happen? How did you go from, I know that we've talked about it a little bit in passing when we were at Comic-Con and probably at Celebration even last year or earlier this year. But how do you go from being a, you know, Star Wars super fan, volunteering, you know, as soon as you can drive type situation for anything Star Wars related? What's that story like from going from there all the way to where now, you know, You're Star Wars Twitter famous and all that kind of stuff going on.
I mean, you want the long version?
Yeah, I do. I really want to hear this story. It's amazing.
Yeah, so, I mean, I got into Star Wars when I was probably about 8 years old. Mm-hmm. And I was, you know, I was part of that generation that essentially missed Star Wars, like what we call the dark times. So... I was basically growing up after Return of the Jedi, but before even the special editions of the prequels. And I was the only one of my friends that was super into Star Wars. Like, to the extent that my mom, because my mom is awesome, would actually go to garage sales and find Star Wars toys at garage sales. That way I would have Star Wars toys to play with, because you couldn't find them in stores anymore. Wow. And I would do things like read the Star Wars source books, because the source books were the only piece of new Star Wars, you know, content I could get.
Oh, yeah.
And I always said I wanted to work for Lucasfilm. And ironically, my backup plan was Imagineering.
Also, that Galaxy's Edge thing really is a pretty special thing for you.
Yeah, like, I'm working for Lucasfilm, and I'm Imagineer adjacent. And so, yeah, I never really had a plan of how to do that, how to work for Lucasfilm, or what I wanted to do. It was always just like that weird pipe dream of like, yeah, I want to work for Lucasfilm. And, you know, so I continued on with real life, never expecting to actually be able to do that. I actually started a record label when I was 18, and that was kind of my main occupation for a while. And then I was... I think pretty much right when I started, like right after high school, right as I, early college, I had the opportunity to volunteer at, I think it was Comic-Con was my first one, Comic-Con in San Diego, for what was then Paizo Publishing, who were the ones that used to run the Star Wars fan club.
Oh, okay.
And they did kind of an open call for volunteers, because that was a thing you could do back then. I don't think you'd get away with it now. And so I volunteered, and I worked at that convention putting action figures into plastic cases for, you know, 9 to 10 hours a day. And through that I met Mary Franklin, who was who became the head of fan relations at Lucasfilm. And Mary is amazing, and so I continued to volunteer for Mary for several years. And through that, I met the guys that were running StarWarsShop.com. I don't know if you remember that at all.
I remember it. Of course, Sam and Nathan wouldn't, but I do, yeah.
Yeah, it was cool. We used to have an online store. And so I was going to school for visual communications, which is like kind of like graphic design. And I'd known those guys from conventions, from helping them at cons and everything. And at one point they needed a freelance graphic designer just to do, like, you know, really low level design, like, you know, banner ads and adjusting the sizes of images on their website and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Like, nothing work, but they thought of me because they knew I was going to school for that. And so I was actually able to do freelance graphic design for Star Wars Shop, which was awesome. And I'm like, oh my God, I kind of work for Lucasfilm now. Like, I'm a freelancer and I'm working from home, but still technically I get a paycheck from Lucasfilm. And eventually you know, after doing that for maybe over a year, maybe 2 years even, the main guy that I worked with there, kind of day to day, who was one of the buyers, let me know that he was leaving. And I was like, well, that's interesting. So I put in for his job, knowing absolutely nothing about buying. and basically just told John Friel, who was the manager at the time, like, hey, dude, I know your audience. I know your product. I know your website. You can teach me the buying stuff, right? and John, being a saint of a man, totally hired me and took me under his wing and taught me all of the buying stuff and also product development. So I did all the exclusive product development for the site as well.
Oh, that's awesome.
And that was how I really got my foot in the door with Star Wars.
Wow.
And then I guess from there, when they decided to close the online store, we were technically part of StarWars.com, and I made a pretty natural transition from Star Wars Shop to the StarWars.com team as content manager for all the content that was on StarWars.com.
Okay.
And then eventually social media fell on my lap, and that was a whole thing. Social media is hard. I don't recommend it to anybody. The best thing to come out of me working in social was that I was able to hire somebody to work under me on the social side, and that somebody was Andy.
Oh, neat.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So that was cool. I was able to hire Andy, and she's one of my best friends. I was one of her bridesmaids.
That's really cool.
And it's so cool to see like everything now that she's gone on to do in the company that she definitely wasn't hired to do, and you know, was able to really make a whole new role for herself there.
That's awesome.
That's amazing.
I told you this was a long story.
No, I love it. No, keep going.
Eventually in 2012, before the Disney acquisition, but after George was retiring and Kathy took over, in the very first meeting that she ever did with the entire company, she mentioned, she's like, I'm going to start a story group that's going to oversee the narrative storytelling in Star Wars. And I looked to John Friel, who was still my manager at that time. And I'm like, that's what I want to do.
You're like, yes,
that's where I want to be.
Wow.
And obviously I continued in my, well, I finished off the Star Wars Shop stuff, 'cause that was like right at the end of Star Wars Shop. And then I was with StarWars.com for several years, before eventually, a job popped up in the story group. I had already talked to Kiri, who was running it at the time, and been like, hey, I really want to work for you guys one time. I already told my mom, like, this is what I want to do. And because I told my mom that, she was the one that sent me the job listing.
Oh, that's fun.
And I put in for that job and interviewed and had to go through the entire interview process and, you know, over a month of craziness, even though I knew everybody that I was interviewing with. And I'm pretty sure that I was the only one they actually interviewed for that job, because I think they wanted somebody internal and somebody that knew, I mean, they obviously wanted somebody that knew Star Wars really well. But I think they also wanted somebody that kind of already understood the Lucasfilm system. Sure. And they were also looking for somebody to really take over for comics and be a big part of parks. And those were, you know, comics and parks were two of my huge passions. So I think it was a pretty, I don't think I was like, I don't think there would have been anybody that could have really been a competition for that particular role at that time.
You were born for that role.
Literally.
It feels like I was, at least at that time.
That's so cool. And I love how much your mom is woven throughout the entire story. Just even your start of your love for Star Wars and her buying, you know, action figures at garage sales and stuff like that.
My parents, well, my mom who's still with us is still awesome. And my dad, who passed a few years ago, is, you know, he was a huge part in this too. They were both incredibly helpful to everything I did. The first Star Wars films I ever got to see on the big screen were the special editions.
Yep, that's me too. Interestingly, yeah. I mean, I was a kid when the original trilogy came out, but my family just never went to movies. So, my birthday in 1997 was the first time I saw Star Wars on the big screen.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, my I actually got to see all three of them the day before they were released at the Chinese Theater in Hollywood because my dad called into a radio show and won them for me.
Oh, that's amazing.
Wow.
That's amazing. Yeah, so I've always been curious, what's like a typical day for you working for a story group?
Yeah, I saw you on Twitter one time say it's not nearly as glamorous as people think it is, so this will be fun to hear.
No, it really isn't. I'm in a lot of meetings, so there's a lot of that. And then in between meetings, it's usually, you know, lots of checking email.
And then tours and then, with crazy people that come by to see you and stuff like that.
The occasional tour with crazy people, if I can get it into the schedule. Uh-huh. And then a lot of, honestly, just a lot of reading. I have a couch in my office, which I just literally just crash on my couch and read things on my iPad for hours. Huh. And, you know, make notes in there and send the notes back and forth. It sounds not glamorous, and it's definitely not glamorous, but, you know, it is fun. Being in some of those meetings, especially the ones that are really story-focused, is, you know, it's really cool to be able to kind of develop a story live with other people that you respect and that everybody's kind of on the same page with the same goals. Even when it's working with partners, like working with Respawn for Fallen Order,
right.
You know, they were up in San Francisco early on, probably a few times a month, and we would just sit in a conference room all day and go back and forth, and it never really gets old because you're talking about Star Wars, and even when there's like disagreements and stuff, it never gets heated because everybody may have a different perspective, but everybody is coming at it from the same direction where like they just want to make an awesome Star Wars thing.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so has it ever just kind of, like, hit you? You're sitting there in a meeting talking about the story for Fallen Order or any project, and it just hit you that you are part of making, like, the decisions for the future of Star Wars. Like, that's a big
deal. Or at least story decisions.
Yeah, decisions for Star Wars. I mean, I imagine, like, if I were in that situation, it would hit me pretty hard. So, I mean, has that ever happened to you?
It happens kind of regularly. I feel like there's so many other people in this company that do so much more and that are so much smarter than me that it's really easy to stay grounded. Where I feel like I'm just like this little tiny cog in this massive machine, but that all of the other parts are so good that, you know, it's almost, you know, it's just like inspiration to constantly try to do better and be better.
That's awesome.
And I try not to think too much of like, oh, I had a huge influence on that Star Wars thing, because if I really think about it, I'll probably break down.
So what's like the biggest, you know, of anything that everybody already knows about Star Wars related, what's that one time you heard something was going to happen in a story in one of the movies or the TV series or you know, whatever, and when you heard it, it was like the big reveal for you, it shocked you? Can you look back and say, I can't believe they're going to do that? Is there any moment like that stands out?
Oh man, Those sort of things actually happen more often than you'd think. You know, those moments where you're like, I can't believe we're allowed to do this. Or, I can't believe we're going to get away with this. The one that I can think of that's kind of most topical is actually the end of Vader Immortal, which I don't want to give away because it just came out like 2 days ago.
Yeah.
We got it downloaded. We just haven't played it yet.
Sweet. You see a side of Darth Vader that I don't think we've ever seen before.
Wow.
And it's really cool. And it was something that I was super hesitant about at first. I was really worried, like, oh man, if you see that much of Darth Vader, are you going to kind of ruin the mystique? Mm-hmm. or you know, make him seem weaker? And, mm-hmm. you know, when you're working with somebody like David Goyer, you don't really need to worry about the writing.
Right.
And so, like, being able to really see that story all the way through and work with such an iconic character, it's crazy.
Well, BB Date had another question, but he left to go play Vader Immortal. So, no, I'm kidding. He's still here right now, so go.
So, when you started at the story group, what were the expectations for the future of Star Wars? Like, were they...
Or when the story group was, you know, when you were there at Lucasfilm and that kind of thing was brought in and initiated, what was the vision that they had for, like, the future of Star Wars at the time, at least within the internal conversations?
That's probably not something I can really speak to.
Okay, I was just curious. That's cool.
Yeah.
I don't want to.
You never know what people will take, based on what I say, what people will take out of it.
Oh, well, come on, but Matt Martin said something, so.
Exactly. I'll be very sad if anything I say in this interview becomes like a Screen Rant clickbait thing.
I think we'll be careful about that, all right? Yeah. So we won't let that happen. Okay, cool.
You get so many people listening to the podcast.
Oh, yeah. No, you haven't said anything that I think is going to get anybody on in any trouble. We'll be solid with that.
I try to be careful.
Yeah, I know. You're doing great. Okay, so today's it, though. I mean, it's the day that the final Skywalker saga film is hitting theaters. And right now, people are there. They're watching it. We've already seen it twice at this point. Of course, this is our non-spoiler part of the show, so we're not going to get into any details of it. But as fans, thinking about the fact that this is the end of the Skywalker saga, and that's been said so often at this point, there's a little bit of a bittersweet element to this. What's the mood like there at Lucasfilm as far as like wrapping up all 9 movies? And is it a little bittersweet and melancholy a little bit as far as that goes? Or is it very exciting, looking forward to the future of Star Wars, or a little bit of both?
I wouldn't say melancholy, but... You know, I think there's definitely some bittersweet there, but most of the people here are just kind of such future thinkers, I think, that, you know, they're already excited about the projects that, you know, you guys haven't even heard of, or perhaps I haven't even heard of.
Sure. That's awesome. Well, BB Nate had one more thing he wanted to say, and then we're gonna let you go.
So, I just wanted to say thank you so much for making all of this possible, like Terbus being named, even coming on this show. It's just been so much of an honor for all of this to be happening and how it fell into place. I just wanted to say thank you so much.
And you've gone on record a couple of times saying that it was really John and Derek that or John Barber primarily that made this possible. He had to put it in there. And I know, and you're deflecting, I think, a little bit with that. But I honestly don't think it was our video sending that to him on Twitter that got it done. It was you putting it in those notes. And so that's why BB Nate wanted to thank you for that.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. I'm glad we were able to do that. I hope I hope not too many people get offended when their ideas don't end up getting used.
I know.
Yeah.
Which is a general, you know, a concern about doing things like that and why we, you know, don't typically do it. And I think this was just kind of, we had a really cool opportunity because you were able to bring it up to Ryan personally. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it felt like it had his blessing, that it was just something that was kind of destined to happen. And I was just... I've been looking, obviously, as a Porg fan. I'm always happy to be reviewing anything with Porgs in it, and I was always kind of keeping that in the back of my mind if we ever had an opportunity, and you know, thankfully, John took the opportunity and made it happen.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you know, it's funny, you say you hope other people don't get disappointed in the future and stuff. It's been... We have gotten so many messages since Terbus showed up on on Star Wars Adventures 27 on October 30th. People messaging us on Twitter and social media asking us, help us with this thing, help us with that thing. So I can't imagine what it feels like, all the people messaging you guys or trying to get their things into Star Wars. And so, you know, we were like, this is a one-shot thing. We're not involved in any of this. Don't bug Matt about this. Don't bug anybody about this. Because it was a... You can't, you know, catch lightning in a bottle twice. And something really fun happened for us. And I think a lot of Star Wars fans that kind of got caught up in it. And they were pretty excited about it. I remember when StarWars.com actually released the information about the comic on the week before it came out, and people started messaging us on Twitter, and they were so excited about it because they were finding it before I even knew that it had been announced officially. You know, it's been a lot of fun, but it's not something that's duplicatable, and it's not like you're going to sit there and say, okay, what's my next thing? I'm going to get canonized for somebody. And so I'm telling people, stop doing that. Don't even worry about it. But we want you to know how much we appreciate you just sort of being in our corner this whole time. With this and the graciousness that you've shown a few crazy Star Wars fans through this process. So thank you so much.
No problem.
All right. Thank you for joining us. You know, everybody's going to be looking for the future of Star Wars, and you already know what that is. What's that? That's got to feel crazy. Yeah. But
it's weird, but it's nice that I don't work on everything. So I can still enjoy some things kind of as a fan. I mean, in general, you know, being on the continuity side of things, I always sort of have to know all of the things, but at least I'm not like when I see Rise of Skywalker, I know the story, but it'll be the first time I've seen it. It's not like I've seen bits and pieces over the last several years. And, you know, so I still get to enjoy it to some extent, which
that's
cool.
That's awesome.
Well, that's awesome. Well, we can't wait. Maybe we'll see you again sometime soon. We'd love to, at least we'll see you at Star Wars Celebration, I'm sure, in August of next year, because we're already planning on that. But,
nice.
You know, something else, maybe sometime somewhere else in the future. So thank you so much, Matt, for joining us.
Well, in the mid-1970s, Paul Hirsch was asked to help with editing a little sci-fi film project an up-and-coming director was putting together. Along with Richard Chu and Marshall Lucas, he'd go on to win an Academy Award for an unanticipated blockbuster called Star Wars. Paul Hirsch has become one of the most respected editors in the movie industry, having worked on films like Ferris Bueller's Day Off, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, Footloose, Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol, Carrie, and of course, The Empire Strikes Back. Paul Hirsch was nominated for an Academy Award a second time for the film Rey, and he's the author of the book A Long Time Ago in a Cutting Room Far, Far Away, My 50 Years Editing Hollywood Hits. Tatooine Sons is honored to welcome Paul Hirsch to the show. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So I've got to ask, you know, when you hear the word Star Wars 42 years later, when you hear those two words, what's the first thing that you think of?
I think that'll be the first line in my obituary.
That's true. That's cool. So now let me ask you this. You know, you, from what I understand, you were at some kind of a screening of a movie, and that's the first time you met George and kind of heard about the whole idea of Star Wars. Tell us a little bit about what that was like.
Right. Well, I had edited a number of films for Brian De Palma.
Right.
And one of the films we did together was called Phantom. It's called Phantom. And there was a screening. It was an independent production, and it was picked up for distribution by 20th Century Fox. And there was a lot of excitement about it because it was apparently the largest sum ever paid in a negative pickup deal by a studio at that time. And I was in New York, where I lived at the time, and Brian had flown to Hollywood for screenings and so forth. And he called me up and he said, "The excitement out here is fantastic. You got to come out. We're having a screening at the studio at Fox." So I flew out and went to the screening. And after the screening, there's a little after party. And there were people milling around. And this woman came up to me and she said, "Are you the editor?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Hi, I'm Marshall Lucas, and my husband wants to meet you." Now, you know, David, when you introduced me, you said this little film. It wasn't a little film.
Oh, it was sarcasm a little bit, obviously.
But even though the success was unexpected, there was a lot of attention given to it because George had directed American Graffiti, mm-hmm. which for return on investment was the most successful film Hollywood had ever put out.
Wow.
Of course, cost about $700,000 and made $50 million. So there was a lot of attention on George already. Anyway, she said, "Oh, you know, my husband wants to meet," and she grabbed me by the hand, pulled me through the crowd, and introduced me to George. And the thing about George is he seems like an ordinary guy, but he's really extraordinary. Mm. So he looks like just anyone else, but he combines sort of a brilliant creative mind with a brilliant business mind as well. You very rarely see the two in the same person, but he's very, you know, he's singular in that respect, I would say. So, so that was it. And then the picture of Phantom ran into some difficulties with infringement of different rights. We had to change the title of the film to Phantom of the Paradise, and we had to recut the picture to eliminate certain things that were causing threats of lawsuits and so forth. So it started out with a bang, ended up with a fizzle. But 40 years later, there was a cast and crew reunion screening at the Cinerama Dome in Hollywood, and the place was packed.
Oh, wow.
With rabid enthusiasts. And the thing about movies that wasn't true when I started out, you know, if you worked on a picture that was a flop, you know, it would go away, you'd never see it again. And it was sort of, you know, you bury your failures. But in fact, what has happened with the changing technology over the years is that these films never go away. And they have these long lives. And some of them, for, you know, the release of a film is just the birth. And some of them go on to have long lives. And you never know if they're going to become famous or fall into, you know, obscurity. And Phantom is one of these pictures that picked up an audience along the way and mm-hmm. has become a cult favorite. Mm-hmm. They have an annual festival in Winnipeg, Canada, called Phantom Palooza or something. it has its fans.
That's awesome. So that how did George describe the movie to you when he was telling you about it?
Which, Star Wars?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well, it didn't happen exactly that way. I mean, I go into it in great detail in the book. The Star Wars chapter is the longest chapter in the book, of course, although it was only 8 months out of my mm-hmm. 50-year career. So, but I know it's the thing that interests most people the most. But how I got involved is sort of a complicated story. What happened was they shot the picture in the UK, and at the end of production they screened the cut that the editor had put together, and they were very unhappy with it, Marcia and George. And George's strength in film school was as an editor, and he once told me that he loved editing more than anything else, and the only reason he became a director was so he would have film to edit. And then he told me the only reason he became a writer was so he'd have something to direct. So he really thinks in editorial terms, and to the point that when he was directing the movie, he was imagining where he would make the cutting point, and that's where he would call cut. So a lot of times you wish a shot would have lingered. I mean, but he was imagining, well, we'll cut there, and then the camera cut, and then you're stuck. You know, later on you may decide you want to extend the shot, but there's nothing there. Mm. So it was a learning experience for everyone, I'm sure. But anyway, they fired the editor and they came back through New York. At that time, I'd been working with Brian De Palma on Carrie, which was the second film after Phantom. We had done Obsession in between. Mm-hmm. And I was working on Carrie, and we had a cut at that point, and invited Marsh and George to view it. And they did, and they liked it and went off to California. And a few weeks later, Marcia called up and she said, look, we are not going to be able to finish in time with just Richard and me. Are you available to come out and help us? And I said, so actually what happened was my wife was pregnant at the time with our first child. So I went back and I said, what do you think? And I've been offered this job. I'd love to do it. And she said, do it. So I left her and went off for about 3 months. She eventually joined me out there. But that's how I got involved in it. I had come to L.A. To oversee the finishing of Carrie at the lab here. And I was staying at the of course, I can't think of the name now, the hotel on Sunset Strip. And George sent me a copy of the script, and I opened it up and started to read it. And I'm reading about X-Wings and Y-Wings and Wookiees. And, I'm thinking, okay, all right, I'm not sure what I'm reading here, but, at that time you couldn't conjure up a mental picture of what a Wookiee looked like or sounded like. But I was game and jumped in with both feet, and eventually I worked on the picture longer than any other editor, which is why they chose to put my name in first position.
Wow.
But, we all contributed to it.
Sure. That's amazing. Now, did they show you sort of the whole cut of the film that they had in place before you started editing, or were you just sort of like going in there and doing segments at a time, or how did the process work on editing this film, and what did you think about the story as you were doing that?
Well, when I got to California, Marcia was involved in building the end battle, which was a huge, complicated project on its own, and Richard had started recutting the picture from reel one. And I asked George, and I said, I'd like to run the picture. He said, no, don't do that. Just take the next reel and start working on the next reel. So I grabbed reel two, and then Richard finished reel one and went on to three, and then we sort of leapfrogged over each other, recutting the reels. And at a certain point, ILM needed to have the end battle locked down so they could begin shooting the effects for it. And at that point, Marcia had a sort of a longish cut of it, and we broke it in two. George gave Marcia the first. There are three trench runs in the end battle, and Luke's is the final one. So he asked Marcia to work on the first two trench runs and gave me the final trench run. So we worked on it individually for a couple of days, and then we joined the two sequences, and for about two or three days, we tag team edited the sequence with one of us sitting at the cam and the other two sitting on the couch behind. So I would be at the cam making changes and so forth, and Marcia and George would be calling out ideas. And then after a few hours, we would switch, and Marcia would drive, and I'd sit with George, and we kept this process going for two or three days until we locked the sequence. The urgency of locking the sequence was that the studio wanted to cut it to eliminate the end battle.
Oh, wow.
And they said, look, they rescued the princess. It's over. We don't need anymore. But George was determined that it had to have the end battle. So it was important to get that in the works before they ran out of money, so the studio couldn't eliminate the sequence.
Wow. So when did you get to see the whole story take place, and when did, like, understand, from the beginning to the end, this big mythical fantasy space opera thing that was going on? Was it after the entire movie was completely cut and produced and ready to go, or was it during the editing process that you kind of got a better understanding of the whole story?
Well, during the editing process, it's essential that you watch the
right.
whole movie.
Okay.
That's what you're presenting to the audience. You're not presenting scenes. You're presenting an entire experience. And you have to have that experience in order to know how it feels. So we watched, as soon as Richard and I finished our polishing of the reels, we joined it all together and looked at it. And then, of course, what always happens is you see things you never saw before. And then we go back through it and you start saying, well, do we really need this scene? If it's a little bit long, it seems to be slowing down at this portion of the story. Can we get rid of this scene? Or is this scene in the right place? Or, there are a number of, there are all sorts of problems that come up only when you view it as a whole. But it wasn't until after we had fixed all the things that George was unhappy about in each scene before we looked at it all together. So for me, it was a process of discovery. I'd finish a reel and I'd pull out the next reel to look to watch it, to work on it. And I'd watch that reel, the 10 minutes that I was going to work on next. And I'd be, wow, they swing across a moat, it was just dazzling, all the stuff there. The sword fighting in hallways, and, it was like Robin Hood. And there's so many genres referred to and mixed up, and it was like a chopped salad of all the film genres you've ever seen before and sort of combined in a fresh way that made it feel new but familiar at the same time. So it was just, it was so smart and exciting. And it was intended to be a movie for children, but it turns out that it spoke to the child in each of us.
Yeah.
Which is what we didn't expect,
That's awesome. So when did you realize that this was something that was going to be really special? Not just a really fun movie to work on with lots of fun sequences and a great story, but something that was going to be, nobody could have predicted what it became, but that it was going to be something more special than you could have anticipated.
Well, we got a hint of that when the second week it was out, it made more money than the first week. And then the third week, it made more money than the second week. And the fourth week, it made more money than the third week. And the grosses were building from week to week for about 6 months. It just kept going up. The weekly take was bigger, and you never see that. Of course, the distribution patterns and practices are very different now than they were then. But still, that constant build was it was at that point that we realized it was something big.
Yeah.
The reviews were not particularly flattering, not universally so. There was a lot of, critics, they love being snarky and condescending if they can. It's what they live for, And so there's a lot of criticism of the acting and so forth. A few of the critics, recognized that it was a great ride. But it's more than that. It wouldn't have been as universally popular if it had just been an exciting ride. I think there's a deep moral underpinning that appeals to people all over the world that I don't think you can have a really successful popular film without that kind of moral basis.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Star Wars had that, and it spoke to the best of what a human being can be,
And I think, that's one of the things that has drawn myself and now my sons, having grown up in the original trilogy era, and now I've got 18-year-old and a 14-year-old son that are growing up in this era, and we get to talk Star Wars. We end up having our show ends up talking about the morality and the ideas of good and evil and friendship and loyalty. All those things that George mentions so often are part of that. That's so awesome. Now, you've said in the past that film editing and sort of composing music, or at least the way that movies and music work, are sort of flowing together, or they're very similar in the way that they work. Explain what you mean by that, because music is such a critical part of the success of Star Wars, and editing obviously is as well. So explain what you mean a little bit about that.
Well, in the early 20th century, there was a film theoretician named Michio Kanuto who talked about film as a new art form. And this is 1912 or something like that. So This is very, very early on, and he was the first person, I believe, to think of film as an art form. And he referred to previous art forms as rhythms of space, which he called painting, sculpture, and architecture, and rhythms of time, which were music, poetry, and dance. And he said these are the six lively arts, and he proposed cinema as the seventh art, the seventh. So I think what he was pointing out was that cinema encompasses both rhythms of space and rhythms of time. And the all the arts that are essential to making a film have antecedents. Cinematography has antecedents in painting and photography, of course. And production design, you have architects, you know, building sets and so forth. So there's like a historical basis for all the elements of the different crafts that contribute to making the film. But editing is native to film. There wasn't anything like it before. And what it deals with in, is the I go into this in some detail in the book too.
Good.
But of all the aspects of filmmaking, editing is the one that deals with time. So in that sense, it's like music, because you're having to be aware of the pace of things. It's not only the order in which we present the details to the viewer, but the pace at which they come to the viewer. And that's something that editing shares only with music. If you look at a painting, you know, in a gallery, you come up to it, you see the whole thing first from a distance, and then you get closer to it and you start to see the details that comprise the painting. With a building, you come up to it, but you see only one side of it. And to really understand the building, you have to walk around it and through it. And then after you've taken in all the details that make up the building, then you get a mental picture of what the whole building is. So you're getting the details before the whole, whereas with painting, you get the whole before the details. In literature, the details are laid out in a particular order. In a building, you can wander around in any direction you want. So, but in literature, you're guided through chapter one, chapter two, and so forth. And the artist is controlling the sequence of details to which you're exposed. Editing takes into consideration the order, but also the pace at which it's coming at you. So in that sense, it's like music.
That's awesome. So now, am I correct in my understanding that the sort of the famous transition wipes in the sequences were your ideas? That's that Star Wars is so known for. Was that your idea?
Well, I didn't invent wipes, you know.
No,
I
mean, but wipes, using it in the film for, yeah.
Well, I always liked wipes, you know. In my very first film, it was called Hi Mom with Brian De Palma. Bob De Niro was the lead. And I had been working cutting trailers and had been exposed to optical houses. And when you go to the optical house, there's a chart that shows you all the wipes you can do. A wipe this way, a wipe that way, a wipe down, a wipe up, separating, coming together. They have a little graphic display of all the wipes. And I thought they'd be fun. You know, I used to, I found them fun to play with. And we used them in Hi Mom. And then when I got to Star Wars, it was so clear that the origin of the idea of Star Wars was to be similar to the old Buck Rogers or Flash Gordon serials from Saturday mornings. Kids, if you look at your history books, you'll find that in the early years of the 20th century, they used to have Saturday matinees, and they would show a new episode of continuing story every week. And it always end with a cliffhanger, and then you'd have come back the following week and find out what happened. So since the movie was in the spirit of movies of the 30s, The wipes were something that was popular then, and I thought it would be in keeping with the intent of the movie to have wipes. In addition to which, I always find that if you're going to another, you know, it's nice to have some movement on the transition. So I like them. That's awesome. George liked them too, so we went with them.
That's cool. Now, so you know, where were you, and what was your reaction? Because you're famous for having said that you won an Academy Award before you'd even thought about winning an Academy Award. That's something that you've said. And so, where were you when you heard that you'd been nominated, and what was your thought process behind that when it hit you?
Well, actually, when I came back from California, and we saw how popular the film was, Brian De Palma said to me, he said, "You're going to win an Oscar." And I thought, "What?" And he, "Yeah, you're going to win an Oscar." So he had planted that idea in my mind, and you know, it was amazing. I mean, the minute I heard I'd been nominated, I went on a diet. You know? I was going to be on TV, you know. So that was very exciting. What was I doing? I don't remember.
It's been a while.
Yeah, a lot of dailies since then.
That's right. That's right. So now you also were the editor on Empire, Empire Strikes Back. So obviously the most iconic moment in all of Star Wars history, and potentially all of movie history, is the "I am your father" moment. Did you know about that moment? What was going on, or was that sort of kept from you as well?
No, it was kept from everyone.
Wow.
George and Larry Kasdan had written a line to, I forget what it was. Actually, I guess I could find the script and look it up.
It was "Obi-Wan is your killed your father" is what it, for what I understand it was.
"Obi-Wan killed your father"?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we thought, okay, cool. Well, that's cool, you know. And then, of course, when we finished the film, we replaced the line that they shot on the set with James Earl Jones saying the famous line.
So did you see that happening during the editing process, I'm assuming, then? And what was your reaction when you found that out? Was it as sort of a Star Wars fan, to some extent, did you react the same way that everybody else did?
Yeah, when George told me the real line, I thought, oh, my God, that's really cool. It's funny about these, you know, the excitement that you feel when you're working on a movie is most intense when you get an idea. You think of something, you think, oh, my, this is real. I have a great idea. So that's the most exciting moment. Then you do it and you see it and it comes out the way you had hoped. And you go, and that's the next level of excitement. But it's not quite as exciting as getting the idea. And then when you take it and you show it to other people and they react the way you hoped they would react, it's exciting, but it's not as exciting as the first two. It's like a diminishing level of excitement, because the most exciting part is getting the idea.
That's awesome. So outside of the Star Wars universe, you've done, you know, so many other amazing films that are, you know, well-loved and everything else. I know that it's kind of like asking you who's your favorite child, but what's your favorite one that you look back on outside of the Star Wars universe? What would be your favorite film that you worked on, or the one that you're most proud of?
Well, that's like asking me who my favorite child is.
Yeah, exactly. That's good. That's
good. I'll tell you. The film I heard most about from people is Ferris.
Yeah.
After Star Wars, the one that gets, you know, the most, oh, that's my favorite movie. Oh, that, you know, I love that movie. It was Ferris.
Yeah. No, it's a classic for sure.
Yeah. That's Ferris amazing. People love Ferris.
Absolutely.
I understand Matthew Broderick to this day, when he walks around New York, you know, people see him and they say, "Taking the day off, Ferris."
That's awesome. So now, if you were going to give advice to, because we've got lots of generations. We got, you know, dads and moms and their kids that listen to our show. And so lots of those kids are big movie fans, and they're, you know, some of them are thinking about getting involved in the movie industry. And if you were to give advice to someone that was thinking about getting into film editing, what would be like the most important piece of advice you'd give someone like that?
Go back to school and get into medical school. I don't know. The business is so different today from the business that I started out in. The challenges facing kids trying to get in the business today is very different from what I was dealing with. And, you know, it's just a whole different world. I mean, back then, it was very difficult to get any practice at editing because you couldn't get your hands on anything to cut. You didn't have the tools. You didn't have the materials. Today, you know, some young people on the internet are doing amazing things. So I don't know how you get to the point where people will pay you to do it. It's a mystery to me. But I would say in general, I think it helps to be as educated as possible in anything you do. And when people tell me they are interested in going to film school, I tell them, you know, study literature, study psychology, study history. Film is very easy to pick up. The how-to, you know, that's relatively easy. But what's important is having something to say and wanting to communicate something of substance. I think that's, you know, severely in short supply these days. But yeah, I mean, if you want to be an editor and you enjoy editing, then cut as many things as possible and network with people. I know assistant editors who get most of their jobs from other assistant editors, not from editors, but they hear about the job from somebody else. So network with your contemporaries and your peers, practice your craft, do it as much as you possibly can, and when an opportunity turns up, just say yes without hesitating. Because entry-level jobs are 99% attitude and 1% aptitude. Mm. So it doesn't matter how brilliant you are if you're surly and uncommunicative and unhelpful.
That's good.
The people that do the hiring want people around them that are positive and energetic and agreeable.
That's awesome. Well, thank you, Paul, so much for joining us on this episode, our special 100th episode edition here. We are so excited. Everybody needs to really go and check out that book that came out a couple of weeks ago, your book a long time ago, At a Cutting Room Far, Far Away, My 50 Years of Editing Hollywood Hits. It's not just Star Wars. It's some of the greatest movies people have seen, some of the most fun movies out there. Check it out. Read about these stories. Thank you so much for being a part of our special edition here, Paul.
You're more than welcome.
All right. That was awesome. Those interviews were great. It was so much fun having Matt and Paul on this. Thank you guys so much for being a part of our 100th episode. All right. But you guys are probably here. I mean, those are fun things to listen to. But if you're listening to this show and you've made it this far, it's because you want to hear our thoughts on The Rise of Skywalker coming next.
Rebellions are built on hope.
If you live long enough, you see the same eyes in different people.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Okay. That was a really... a helpful
song
intro. It's like, I'm zenning out now. I'm comfortable.
You won't be able to in a little bit, though.
I'm relaxed. I'm ready to talk. Let's talk spoilers, okay? For The Rise of Skywalker. All right, I don't even know where to start, but let's just deal with.
talk
through the show, talk through the movie, the opening scene. Let's just talk about sort of the Kylo stuff.
Play
at the beginning.
By play, kind
of. Not really. I don't want to get into because I want to get into characters. I want to get into some surprises. Yeah. I want to get into what you talked about last night. But the opening of the scene, Kylo Ren is going medieval on a planet. He is like tearing it up. They establish the opening of this movie to tell us how absolutely evil Kylo Ren is.
Right.
Explain kind of what your thoughts were watching that opening, Samuel.
It was a little scary because he was just like pure rage.
Yeah.
There was like no thought behind what he was doing. He was just killing and stuff. It was like something you'd see Vader do almost. I almost felt bad for like the guys he was killing because I don't know why, but I thought they were kind of cute. So I was like, "Why are you
cute?
Yeah,
really?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, they're like villagers on some planet.
Yeah, I know. Like, why are you
that
killing
planet?
Them?
When I first saw it, I'm like, "Oh, it's moving so far
from the space. Oh, from it the did space, look
it
like,
but then I'm like, "Wait, it's probably, you know, I don't want to spoil the Vader
no, you're spoiling. You can spoil now.
Well, it's Vader Immortal.
Oh, okay, yeah. No, it's not moving so far. So. All right, so he's on this planet. It gets to the end, BB Nate, of this like moment where he's just killing everything in his path. And he's standing there, and there's 30, 40 dead bodies. A few of them are First Order stormtroopers that were with him. And it's like he was killing, and he didn't care if they died. He was just going to kill everything in his path. Why is he on this planet, BB Nate?
Well, he's doing it to find a Sith Wayfinder.
Explain what that is.
Well, it's kind of like there's only two of these made, and they look a little bit like a Sith holocron, but they're a way to get to
Exegol.
Exegol. That's what
Exegol is the planet. Yeah,
Exegol. And it's.
Do you know how long I've been wanting to say the word Exegol on this podcast? Like 6 months. That's how long I've known about the name of that planet.
Wow.
Yeah. So anyway.
But he finds it, and
why is he looking for it?
Well, he's. To get to Exegol because the Emperor is apparently there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Let's just back up for a second. What was your thoughts on that title crawl?
That was they were just going straight
in. The Emperor is alive, or his voice is out in the world. You know, that type of thing. What did you think about that when you read that? Because you had not read the title crawl.
No.
Okay.
It didn't seem too surprising to me. When I was reading it the first time.
Okay.
Pretty much made sense to me. I'm trying to remember the title crawl right now.
They're talking about the Emperor's voice has been heard. He's alive. Everybody's kind of freaking out about it.
It all seemed reasonable the first time I read it.
Okay.
So, yeah. No, it wasn't too crazy.
What about you, BB Nate?
I was... The Emperor's voice is being heard. That was a little bit, you know, surprising to me. But that was really the only thing that gave me a lot of surprises in the title crawl.
Can I be honest with you? Yeah. I think the title crawl was probably the weakest part of the movie for me.
Yeah.
It didn't really it was kind of like, oh.
But the title crawl always kind of does that.
Okay. I mean, it was just setting up the story with it. It was on from there. Okay, so he gets there. Kylo Ren ends up in Exegol. He starts hearing these voices. Now we've all seen that clip. If you've watched the stuff that Disney and Lucasfilm has been releasing, we even talked about it on the last episode. You know that he's hearing these voices, and it's Palpatine who's been pretending to Snoke. But what about in those cylinders? He gets in Exegol. He sees those cloning chambers.
Yeah,
right.
What does he see inside there?
Snoke's.
What does this mean?
Well, Palpatine did say, I made Snoke, so I'm assuming that the Emperor literally made Snoke to control Kylo Ren.
That's pretty intense. Now, this is a story we don't have an answer to yet.
Well, that's hopefully what we're going to get in the Rise of Kylo Ren series. I feel like that's
going to be I think we're going to get that stuff.
Which we're reading that comic. Here's the thing, all right? There are lots of questions after this movie. Is this correct?
Yes.
Okay, but
let's stop there. Like, let's think about all the different things that we don't have answers to at this point.
How the Emperor made it.
What? Right, like how is he alive? Mm-hmm. Okay.
What the deal is with Snoke.
Okay.
Yeah.
The Knights of Ren.
Yeah. Well, we're going to learn that in The Rise of Kylo Ren.
Right.
I think a lot of that we learn in The Rise of Kylo Ren.
All of those more. People in the stands at the end. I'm wondering what they
what the heck was
They're all in robes. I'm telling you, on the second viewing, they all looked like they could be the Emperor. I'm wondering if they're clones of the Emperor.
I just feel like they're like followers of like the Sith religion or something.
Well, I think that they are with it, but in the end, you know, that's.
But I mean, there's a lot that could happen.
Lots of questions.
Yes, but with it, I'm sure we're going to get lots of answers. With
all right, Scott. Let's talk about things that might. And again, if you're listening to this, we're assuming you know the entire plot line already, so we're not going to like. Walk through the entire movie bit by bit. I want to jump around. Well, yeah, I want to jump around a little bit and talk about some different things. Things that people could potentially suggest are reversals of The Last Jedi or digs at The Last Jedi. Let's address some of those.
Rey being a Palpatine or her father being a Palpatine.
Yeah, I mean, it goes from she's a nobody.
And I can completely understand where you're coming from that, but they also keep it with they were nobody. He says
they chose to be nobody.
They were nobody because they chose to be nobody. So there we go. It still stays with Rian Johnson, but it explains her parents a little bit better because we knew that the story wasn't over. So,
but doesn't this seem to start to play into the narrative of well, the Force is just about bloodline now. And Rey is only strong in the Force because she's a Palpatine. Kinda. What do you guys think about that?
I got a bad sort of feeling about this.
But at the end, it almost seemed like once he drained the Force out of her, she then like was able to tap into the Force just by tapping.
Okay, so when you're talking about that, that's Force Dyad, right? Which we talked about as a theory. 4 months ago on this show. Yeah,
but
what did you guys think when they started using that phrase and stuff?
I was like, we nailed it. Yeah.
But I don't feel like it's like the bloodline or the lineage that has to do with the Force. We're starting to learn a little bit more about that. Even with Maz Kanata. We know that she kind of sets the Force.
Well, let's talk about this because I think that there was a deliberate choice on J.J. Abrams' part and Chris Terrio, who helped write this, their part in this film. They made a choice with a character to help reinforce that this idea that the Force isn't about bloodline because they knew they were going to be bringing in this Rey Palpatine idea. And that's Finn.
Yeah.
Think about that.
And all those, and the other stormtroopers, they all had the feeling. And it just, the whole company, when they were told to shoot, they all put their blasters down. And affected.
Oh, yeah, with Janna?
Yeah, I found that to be pretty cool, how the whole company did it.
What do you think about the idea that Finn is Force-sensitive? It's pretty in your face.
Right.
In this movie. Let's talk about that before we talk about a little tweet, a nugget that applies to us on that. But what do you think about the idea? Is that, do you think that JJ is brought that into this storyline with Finn and then with Janna and suggesting that maybe everybody can tap into it. It has nothing to do with bloodline. You've got people that don't even know their lineage that have the Force to counterbalance, do you think, the idea that Rey's a Palpatine so that they can continue that idea from The Last Jedi?
Yeah, I think that was a deliberate choice. When we were talking about, like, Finn being Force sensitive, I was a little nervous about them pulling that off. I wasn't a huge fan of it, but the way he portrayed it in this movie really worked. I think it was a deliberate choice to counteract the whole Rey's being a Palpatine thing, to counteract the whole you had to be from a certain lineage or a certain bloodline to be Force sensitive.
Because Broom Boy and everything from The Last Jedi is the Force is for everybody. Right, and Luke's concept is the Force is from everybody, but in the end, Rey's a Palpatine. So we've got to be able to balance that. Okay, what about we're on Octu? Rey has just torched Kylo's TIE Whisperer.
Yes,
That's what it is, right?
Time Whisper, yeah.
Yeah. She's decided to get rid of the legacy lightsaber. She's no longer going to do this. And she chucks it at the fly at the fire. And what happens?
Well, a force ghost Luke grabs it, which I don't know if that really made sense to me. I'm still trying to figure that one out.
How? Well, like he physically interacted? Yeah. Well, force ghosts have been physically interacting.
Yeah, but it's just, I totally forgot about that when I was watching it. I'm like, how does that work again?
Yeah, no, well, I mean, Obi-Wan sits down on a log. Yoda burns down the tree. They've been able to interact with the physical realm with it. But what was it that Luke says? Do you guys recall? I caught it the second time. Go.
Yeah, a Jedi's weapon should be treated with more respect or something to that effect.
There's going to be people.
I got a bad feeling about this.
They're going to say that's a dig at opening moments in The Last Jedi with Luke.
Oh, yeah. And I think it is, but it's almost Luke saying, like, realizing how foolish he was at the time.
Yeah, Luke is the Luke that we wanted him, that fans wanted him to be. He's become that now as he's transcended into the Force, right? And that happens at the end of The Last Jedi.
Right.
He becomes the Luke of everybody's dreams at the end of The Last Jedi, and it's carrying through. He's telling Rey on Ahch-To, you can't run from your fear. You can't give up on this. He's become the Jedi. He's become the Yoda.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In this film.
I think that's fair.
Okay. What are some other things that might be retcons?
I can't really see any other ones at the moment.
No, I think those are the only two.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, they talked about the Holdo maneuver, but...
They joke... Oh, and that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
About that.
We saw something... Like, at the end, we saw a Holdo maneuver. Because the forest moon of Endor, you look up and you see a Star Destroyer split in two, and it looks just like...
Somebody may have done it?
Yeah.
Interesting. It was Beaumont, which is kind of cool because that's got a Terbus connection for us from Star Wars Adventures 27 through 29 with it. Which, by the way, we finished that arc. I'm honestly, Terbus is the hero of that story. Mm-hmm. And Beaumont's like, why don't we just Holdo this thing? Did he even say Holdo maneuver?
Yeah, he said, why don't we just use Holdo maneuvers.
Yeah,
do some real damage.
And they're like, you can't keep, you know, that's a one million
shot.
I thought that was pretty interesting that they did that to answer that concern from The Last Jedi with it. Okay, no other retcon moments?
I don't think so.
All right, favorite character or favorite storyline in this?
Oh, jeez.
Oh, come on, you guys, we gotta talk about this.
Well, favorite new character is gonna obviously be Babu Frick.
Oh, as far as new characters go?
Yeah.
If it was a new character for me, it would have to be Dio.
Really? You like Dio?
Cool.
So, I don't know if you guys know this. I think I told you guys last night, but if you're listening to this, the voice of Dio is actually J.J. Abrams. And it's fun watching the movie knowing that.
Right.
With it, because it's like, oh my gosh, that sounds just like
JJ. He responds to everything, like, how it's going on, like, sad.
Yeah.
He says his emotions and stuff.
Yeah, oh yeah. Sad. That's awesome. Cool. Well, he has no expressions at all on that hairdryer face.
Comb
face thing. Yeah. That's what they call him, yeah. Favorite, but as far as, like, the overall storylines, which one's your favorite?
Jeez. I really like what happened with Finn.
Okay.
I really like what they did with his character, not only through this movie, but, I mean, I've talked throughout all three movies. Not only did his character mature, but even John Boyega kind of matured.
As an actor?
Yeah. You can just tell that he became more confident, both his character and himself, throughout the movies.
That's cool. What about you, BB Nate? Which one did you like the best? Which storyline character did you like the best?
Well, I think this is going to be, the cliche answer, but Rey had a really cool storyline just throughout... Like Sam said, the whole three movies, it was just cool to see her transition. She was just really powerful in the Force. Like, right off the bat, she's just levitating with rocks around
her. That was kind of cool.
Yeah, that was cool.
All right, let's just... I'll come back and answer this. Remind me to answer that question, because I want to talk about it. Not right this second. But now we're talking about her and training and hanging in, you know, levitating with rocks and all that kind of stuff. Can we talk just for a second about the flashback scene to Luke and Leia training?
Yes.
That was awesome.
I think this has been established before, but I didn't realize Luke had trained Leia.
It hadn't been 100% established.
Yeah.
It's like full on. Like, she was at the end of her training in this, they say.
Right.
And she was battling against Luke toe for toe.
Bested him.
Like, bested, had him fall down and that kind of thing. And she's the one training Rey. Now, Rey even calls her Master Leia.
Right.
Which awesome. I thought that was so cool. And then what? Just real quick, the CGI of young Luke and young Leia. Dude, what did you guys think?
It was good. Yeah,
I think that Luke was better.
Yeah,
but I think they could use Luke. They can use Mark Hamill for the base of that. They had to use somebody else, like Billy Lord. My understanding, this rumor, by the way, has been floating around for months now that this was going to be in here, that this scene was filmed. And my understanding, I'm not sure if this is true, but my understanding was that Billy Lord actually played Leia, her mother, and then they CGI'd around that for this.
That's cool.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty cool. Okay, so let me come back to my favorite storyline.
We're not going to talk about cool lightsabers?
Well, we'll come back to that.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. My favorite storyline or character in this was without a doubt Finn. I thought it was so cool. And I just want to remind everybody that back like 4 or 5 months ago, we did a whole episode on whether or not Finn was force sensitive. And we concluded on that episode that he wasn't. Not that we didn't want him to be, but that he just wasn't. That they were not going to do that
right
in this. And then a conversation took place on Twitter as a result of that, where somebody made a really strong argument for why they believed Finn was force sensitive. Hold on.
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
Not every word, just one. But anyway, they made this argument, and I think I commented and said that that was a really valid, argument that they made. And then John Boyega tweeted to us and to that person on our timeline a gif of this guy sitting in a car where he turns and faces the camera with this grin on his face like, I know something you don't know. And that sort of sent Twitter into a little bit of a spin for a few days as people were speculating about that. He spoiled it to some extent. We just didn't know if it was real, but he said basically with that gif that he was force sensitive. That was pretty cool. Yeah. I loved that idea. I love the idea that the Force is bigger, that Finn has it. I think Janna has it. I loved his story. I think that his acting was fantastic in it. And I think that that reunion at the end with Poe and Rey, when they're embracing at the end after the celebration, where you could just see the emotion on John Boyega or on Finn. And he just did a fantastic job. I think it was amazing with that. All right. Best fan service.
Oh, geez.
Because this thing was loaded with fan service from beginning to end. Best fan service. I'll let you go first, Sam.
The whole, I think Nate pointed this out, but the whole I am Iron Man, basically.
Explain.
The line from Rey. Palpatine's like, I am every Sith. And then she goes, well, I am every Jedi, and then kills him. And I'm like, oh, that's...
I had not picked up on that.
Yeah, I didn't either.
But I loved it, because it worked.
No, it worked. It did work. And then you had the whole ships assemble thing with all the different ships.
Yeah, there was definitely a Disney, Marvel, Endgame.
And of course it worked.
It worked. It was definitely awesome.
Yeah.
What about you?
Go ahead. I know it worked because when you said best fan service, it took me a second to figure out what they did exactly that was fan service.
Oh, yeah, because
it was still taking me a while. It was there, but it was disguised well enough.
Okay,
I'm still trying to figure it out. Probably the whole Leia was a Jedi. I feel
you like that idea.
I love the idea, and I feel like that was fan service as well. Because everybody's like, I want Leia to be a Jedi because she was in the Legends, trained her, everything, and I feel like that it worked well how they put it in there and how she was training Rey. I felt like that was put in there correctly.
Like, you've got all of the fan service. I know you can't see my very gregarious movements, some big movements I'm doing on this recording right now with my hands. But I talk with my hands, and so if you tied them behind my back, I wouldn't be able to talk. You've got all of the fan service, which I absolutely loved, and then you've got one moment of fan service that's light years ahead for me. Like, super ahead for me.
Okay.
Do you guys have any idea what it might be? Oh, that one was pretty cool. That was a moment. We'll come back to that one. We'll talk a little bit about that in a second. But as far as, I don't see that as fan service as much as a really interesting decision that they made.
What was your fan service?
Luke lifting the X-Wing out of the water on Octu to the exact same soundtrack as Yoda doing it on Dagobah. He's finally done it. Oh my God, okay, I freaked out.
And then his grin was like...
I loved that.
Okay, so where Luke and Leia were training looked a lot like Dagobah. I'm just gonna...
It might have been.
It might have, and I feel like that would work really well... the whole training wise, but I don't know. I don't know where they're.
So what did you guys think though? She's like, I don't have a ship. I can't get back. And I was like, I mean, I knew that was supposed to happen right then and there, but the fact that it did and to see it happen, just I lost it. I was cheering. I have my
hands. Oh yeah. I was excited.
That was where I was fist pumping. You know,
I was excited.
Yeah, sure. That was really cool. All
right. Pure fan service though.
Right. Oh yeah. Let's talk about the Han thing for just a second.
Okay.
All right. That's fan service. I think you're right. They wanted to have one of these films have Harrison, Mark, and Carrie all in the same film to finish up the saga. And I think that's almost the important why they did it. But what was that all about? Is that a vision? Is that a dream? Is he a ghost? What is this?
I think it's exactly what Kylo Ren said. It's a memory. It was patterned exactly off of what happened in Force Awakens.
Yeah, almost the words that were being spoken.
Yeah, it was just he played it out differently. That helped him to make his decision.
Yeah, no, I think it was just Kylo Ren's mind doing it. I don't think it was like a ghost.
Like almost like a ghost of guilt. Right. You know, like he was being haunted. Like Luke says, haunted by, you know, you strike me down and you'll be haunted. What's the line he says in The Last Jedi?
Strike me down and then... anger and I'll always be with you just like your father.
Just like your father.
Yeah. Right.
They set that up in The Last Jedi. Not a retcon.
No.
They set that up in The Last Jedi. Now, as late as last week, there was this line that was going to be inserted in there where Ben's trying to... obviously, it's Ben Solo at this point. Where Ben's trying to tell... He feels like he needs to say I love you to Han, to his father. And he starts to say it in the... as of last week, the script, from what I understood, had him saying the words I love and then getting cut off by Han, where Han says I know, like cutting him off. They chose not to do it. It was more of like Ben standing there saying, Dad, and then not being able to say anything. And Han said, I know. Super emotional moment for me.
Yeah.
Love the tie back to Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi with that. How do you think that they handled that whole interchange between the two?
Yeah, I like that a lot better than Han cutting him off. It's it seemed almost insensitive if it went the first time.
Yeah.
This was a lot more emotional. It hit a lot better. I think it conveyed the correct emotions as well.
Cool.
It was just a very emotional moment, and I feel like if Han cut him off, that would be a little strange, because in that moment, to cut him off...
By cutting him off, it's like he's trying to say, you don't need to say it.
Yeah.
Like I don't want to hear it from you.
But in this one, he already knows that he loves him.
In this one, it's like, I know you're having a hard time saying it, but I also know you love me with it. I thought it was really awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a big thing we haven't talked about.
What?
The new Force power.
Oh.
Healing?
Yeah.
All right.
Healing or teleportation?
No, the teleportation sort of happened in The Last Jedi. Yeah. We'll talk about that. We don't need to talk about that right now. We'll talk about that sometime.
But the healing sort of happened in Mandalorian.
We have people that haven't listened to Mandalorian. Sorry about that, guys. Watch that. Okay, so this idea of Force healing is taking place throughout the movie. Rey heals, obviously, Ben, or Kylo Ren Ben. At about the midpoint of the movie, with this at the end of Act Two, in the film, before the Han scene, and then at the end we see a sort of a Romeo and Juliet type thing happening at the end. Rey dies. We thought Ben was dead. Ben comes back. He actually uses that same power to heal Rey.
Mm-hmm.
But Sam, you mentioned something in between showings last night that I am not hearing a lot of people talk about. So explain for the listeners what you think this is really all about.
Oh, it's clearly he's basically finishing what Anakin started, which was saving the ones he loved from dying. That's exactly what Ben did in that scene.
He you know, and then you go back to the Darth Plagueis story, the tragedy of Darth Plagueis. He talks about the ability to use the Force to create life, but he also uses the Force to like save life and keep people alive, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the whole premise of how Sidious lures Anakin to the dark side in that movie.
Yes.
It's not from a perspective of he's using love, but it's dark side in a dark side of ability, according to Sidious, but right? But how does this work in this one?
It was the Force healing power.
It was light side.
It was solely love.
Light side. Yes.
It was sacrifice, selfless, that type of thing. Anakin wanted to bring Padme back. That's Vader Immortal. That's the Darth Vader Lord of the Sith series. It's all about bringing Padme back from death. Right?
Right.
And there's moments where it's like almost happening.
Yeah.
Using Darkseid in those stories. But in this one, Ben brings back the woman he loves. Whether or not you like that, Reylo is real. With that.
And it worked. Well, but it's not Reylo.
No, it is Reylo. I mean, it is. But, well, it's Solo. You can use that at the end. So, Reylo. So, but anyway, they brings back, he brings back the one he loves from death using love, using the Force. Somebody said something on the way home last night about the Jedi and their attachment.
He brought her back through love. And that's probably why Anakin failed, because the Jedi weren't allowed to love in that sense. If they were allowed to love, perhaps Anakin wouldn't have turned. He would have been able to save Padme. It would have been a very different story.
Do you think, though, that it's like it's literally transferring his Force essence, his Force life.
His life,
period. Into Rey in order to save her. At this point, do you think that there could have ever been a scenario where this power is playing out, where you bring someone back from death? Because they make it really clear that Rey's dead.
Right. Yes.
Her eyes are open. They're glassed over. It's not like she's passed out and in a coma. She's dead.
Yeah.
In this. And he transfers his Force essence into her to bring her back with this. Could there ever be a way that would have happened where Ben Solo survived?
I think if the Emperor hadn't drained so much out of him before he threw him off, he would have been able to bring her back, maybe.
Okay,
maybe.
I it's tough to tell because this is new stuff. This is we don't know, and this is the Force we're talking about. Yeah. It's like you can't quantify it. So.
The thing, I'm not worried about this. Of course, this is if it's Star Wars, it's fine. But again, we did not see Palpatine die, and that's making me nervous.
No, we saw him explode.
He's dead.
He exploded.
He exploded. Saw him disappear.
No.
And then his
throne was free. He's dead.
He exploded.
I'll watch it again.
They made it really clear for me.
Okay, can we talk about that, though? I was kind of worried, though, that the Emperor wasn't actually going to be in the movie. Like, there wasn't even going to be a physical form. It was. Like,
yeah, I thought it was just going to be his voice or something.
Yeah, some, like, sideways way of doing it. But
no, he was all in
right
it.
On and
opening,
early in
opening
the movie.
Moments all the way through the movie. He's in it, physically in it. With it. Hold on.
It's the 100th episode. I just want to say I liked the movie.
Oh! This was fun for us because this was the very first time that Mom joined us for an opening night for Star Wars. Except for Solo. I guess you did Solo because that was Sammy's birthday.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
But as far as like a saga movie or something like that.
Yeah.
I was kind of
expecting it to be more fanny. I don't know if that's
fanny?
Not your hind, but like fan,
like people screaming and yelling,
cheering and lightsabers.
It's a hard movie to take in. It's like it never stops, and so you're.
It was a fast 2.5 hours.
Yeah, they didn't really give you much chance to breathe.
Yep. No, but I liked it, and
awesome.
I'm not a big Star Wars fan.
There we go. All right, so it goes back to your Achuta. It's like poetry. It rhymes.
Wow.
Your Achuta was like, even if you're not a Star Wars fan, you should see this. And
yeah.
A non-Star Wars fan, just go away, Terbus Buster. Go on.
Come on.
the dog came in to join us. All right, let's talk about the end. Very, 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 very end,
which I'm really excited about. All right. That's awesome.
Explain what we see.
Well, we see her go back to Tatooine, you know, find more fan service, but find her, like, a piece of metal, and she slides down the sand.
At the Lars homestead.
Yes, and then she starts looking around and finds this piece of cloth and wraps up Leia and Luke's saber and then buries it in the ground, which was also a new force power that we've seen.
She just used the force.
Well, exactly, but it was pretty cool.
But I think you were, like, more excited to talk about
her saber that she made.
All right, this is a Jedi Fallen Order mini spoiler.
Yeah. Maybe. So, in Fallen Order, you can customize your saber a little bit more because of a specific thing that happens, which is...
Okay, we are talking about that spoiler.
Yeah, because that's a huge spoiler. But you can customize your kyber crystal. And when you get your kyber crystal, you can turn it to choose your color. And so...
You noticed this first viewing, too.
Yes. And so when she turns it on, you see in, like, the grates, before it actually ignites yellow, you see in the grates, it goes blue-green and then yellow to officially. So I'm wondering if it's a dial, it turns the crystal so that it can be whatever.
That's an interesting thing. What do you think about that idea?
No, I love that idea. It kind of helps justify what they did in Fallen Order, because I know why they did it in Fallen Order. It's so that people could have more customization. It's just like a game mechanic. But, like, in canon, why would...
Now we know why in canon it could happen.
Right. So I like that. Not sure why you'd need a saber where you can, like, literally, like, just change the color whenever you want.
Because you got to color coordinate. Like, you know, I mean,
it's cool. Don't get me wrong. I would love to have a saber that I could just change color anytime I want.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Just the closing on Tatooine.
Also, can we talk about how she made it out of her old staff?
Oh, that was cool.
I love that.
And we've kind of thought that might be coming at some point with it. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's double-bladed?
No.
No.
The other end was capped, you could tell.
Was it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I loved it when she was walking away to look at the sunsets, you know, another fan service. The suns were kind of... You see BB-8, and the sun right next to it was...
Was shaped BB-8. Like the way that the suns were overlapping each other.
It was BB-8.
Looked just like BB-8.
What do you think about the ending of it? I mean, is her on Tatooine, the Emperor gone, First Order gone, all that kind of stuff. What do you guys think about the ending of the Skywalker saga?
It was good.
It was good. That's always
really good.
It was interesting. It was good.
Yeah. I want to say that it's a happy ending and everyone's going to live happily ever after. But we thought that was going to happen with Return of the Jedi, too. And clearly that didn't happen. So they could always come back to it and mess things up again. But it feels good.
I don't know what else.
It was satisfying. Using that word again. But... I would have to agree with Daisy Ridley's four words that kind of summed up The Rise of Skywalker. I think it was sad, joyful, scary, and satisfying, I think is what it was. I don't know.
Yeah, there was some scary in it.
There was.
There's so much more that we could talk about.
Yeah.
But we don't have time. No, so we're going to go ahead and last things, guys. Anything else you guys want to say?
Anything else?
Ooh, crap. I wasn't
thinking about this. I would have to just say that Dio is a really good character. I really just enjoyed how they found him. I thought it was going to be made by Bobby Frick, because that was a rumor that Bobby Frick made him. But I really loved just Dio himself and how he was just explaining everything. He's like squeaky wheel.
Yeah, it was fun. What about you, Sam? What's in anything else? Last thing.
Being the spy.
Oh my gosh, there's so much we haven't talked about.
And that there was one thing that I did get spoiled on. It was that Hux died.
Oh, yeah.
That was from...
That was sad. I didn't want that to happen. Because I was just getting to like that guy.
It's total callous moment with him.
Yeah. Oh, totally.
Except for different reasons.
Well,
very different reasons.
He was like, I don't care if you win. I just want to see Kylo Ren lose. But
I thought that he was a plant from the beginning. But when he said that, you realized that he just did it because he's petty and didn't like Kylo.
For me... Probably one of the most heartbreaking scenes or moments in the entire Skywalker saga. I'm going 9 movies here. Was the moment that Chewbacca
found out that Leia died.
Finds out that Leia died.
Oh my gosh. That was terrible.
It was heartbreaking. I was dying there watching it both times. I'm thinking about it now and I'm tearing up. That's like, I don't tear up at Star Wars. Like Luke died. That's it. That's the only moment. even when Han died, my dude, I didn't tear up. This was like, I was freaking out a little bit, and emotional. I knew it was coming with it. All right, so our poll this week is real simple. Give us your out of 10 lightsabers, your ranking.
With halves, on,
No, we can't do it. It's because it's going to be ranges. Out of lights, how many lightsabers do you give this? 1 out of 3, 4 out of 6, 7 out of 9, or 7 to 9, or 10? Lightsabers, and we've kind of given ours on that. That's pretty much going to do it for this 100th episode. So excited about that. I want to thank all of our producers, Michael Conda, DJ Blake, Emily Hoffman, Eric McGilvray, whose 7-year-old kid said it's the greatest Star Wars, greatest movie he's ever seen.
It's awesome. All right.
I agree. I mean, if you're a 7-year-old and you walk away with from that Star Wars movie saying that, then that movie worked. Ian Thompson, Star Wars Doctrine, and then our senior producers, Kate Disney Lugers, Judith Jesse, Roberto Moreno. Thank you guys so much for being a part of our Star Wars celebration and our family. Anything else you guys want to say?
May the force be with you.
May the force be with you.
May the force be with you always.
This party's over.
I like that Wookiee.
Don't get technical with me.
Droid, please.
Yep, yep.
Tatooine Sons, the Star Wars podcast, is not endorsed by Lucasfilm Limited or Disney and is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. The official Star Wars site is located at www.starwars.com. Star Wars, the Star Wars logo, and all names and pictures of Star Wars characters, vehicles, and any other Star Wars-related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Lucasfilm Limited or their respective trademark and copyright holders.